Good evening, everybody from Ortho TV. I'm handing over to Dr. Ashok Shah.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this single cell live institute. He'll be speaking to us today on a very important topic of recurrent lumbar disc herniation, specifically on identifying the cause and what are the treatment strategies for recurrent disc herniation. So I hand it over to Pramod to start his talk, and before that, introduce the panelists. So over to you, Pramod.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening, all. Thank you, Ashok Shyam, sir, for giving the opportunity again. So we have two panelists with us. Number one, Dr. Jayesh Pawar, who is a budding spine surgeon, young spine surgeon located in Mumbai, doing great there. And along with that, we have our own Dr. Divakar Modipalli. He is presently a spine fellow with us. At the same time, he is a very young dynamic surgeon as well. So with this, I would like to start my talk, that is recurrent lumbar disc herniation, which is a very burning question as far as spine is concerned. What are the causes and what are the treatment strategies available for us? So just to start, I'll show a case. I have no disclosures to, I have no company aid, no support, no grant. So this is a case. We have a 62-year-old male who presented us with low back pain, right lower limb radiation, had hypertension and obstructive hydronephrosis as his comorbidities with a creatinine slightly on higher level. He was a known smoker, smoking for last 5 to 10 years. And on examination, he had a distinct right SLR, which was restricted, and there was nil neurology. Patient had significant pain and he was not getting better after 3 months of conservative management. So this was his MRI reports, showed a L4-5 disc herniation. These are the sagittal T2 weighted images. You can see a L4-5 disc herniation. These are mainly the right paracentral cuts. So these are the axial cuts. You can see a right soft disc at right L4-5 level, suggesting, this is a T1 image, suggesting a L4-5 disc herniation on the right side. Not getting better with conservative line of management. So for after 6 months of conservative trial, patient was offered surgery. And we did the surgery in the form of micro-lumbar discectomy. And following which, the patient was very happy. Like with any other lumbar disc herniation surgeries, micro-lumbar disc herniation surgery did very well. Patient went home, no problems. He came back after 1 month for regular follow-up. And after that also, at that time also, he was doing well. Only after a period of 6 weeks, he started complaining of low back pain as well as the right lower limb, some tingling sensation, for which the patient was initially told to just do conservative management, some restriction in activities, some pain management, and along with that, some physiotherapies were advised. But when the patient came during that 6 weeks interim period, patient underwent stent surgery for his hydronephrosis. Patient was having persistent low back pain, also right lower limb pain with a VAS score of 9/10, which was almost same as that of the pre-op status. Now at this juncture, we have already exhausted our conservative line of management. We wanted to know what has gone wrong, what is happening to the patient. Is there something we are missing now? Now, is it a residual disc herniation where we are looking to, or is it the recurrent disc herniation? Since the patient had some asymptomatic period when he was completely fine doing all his activities, the residual disc herniation was ruled out. But yes, can it be recurrent disc herniation? Are we playing with some form of infection? So just to give a brief about what is recurrent lumbar disc herniation, unfortunately, in the literature, we don't have a clear-cut definition what exactly constitutes a recurrent lumbar disc herniation. So accepted definition is occurrence of a herniated disc material at the level of the in a patient who has undergone discectomy. The rate of rehernation reported in various literature ranges from 5 to 25%. And it does vary with the surgical technique you are using, the variability in the follow-up, the different definitions used in the literature, whether it is an ipsilateral one and or contralateral rehernations. In regard to timing, if you consider the time, when would you expect the recurrent disc herniation? So most of them, almost 50 to 60% of them, occur within the first year of the index surgery. So any patient coming within 1 year, you should always and always have a high suspicion of a recurrent lumbar disc herniation. So when we talk about recurrent lumbar disc herniation vis-a-vis a primary disc herniation, does it vary? Is it the same? Are we looking at different parameters here? So these are the definite set parameters which are considered whenever you are dealing with recurrent disc herniation, and more so when the patient is of yours. You have operated the index surgery, the patient revisits you, as we have seen in the previous case, with again similar complaints. That is the time you see that there is always some denial. There is some denial on the patient side that he will always claim that he was completely all right for the last 3 to 6 months. So is it really a lumbar disc herniation? Patient is not ready to accept that. Patient may not investigate also further because he always feels that he was fine, probably some rest and he should do well again. There is a big denial from the surgeon side. I did a fantastic surgery. I had done all the things possible in this world. I've operated the patient to the best of the ability, the same way you would have got operated in Western countries like US and UK. I've done probably the same surgery or even better than that. Then why the patient is having pain? The other important consideration, what you do is anatomic consideration. So compared to a primary disc herniation, here the anatomy is different. Here you have already, and the patient has undergone surgery. So there is derangement of the anatomy. There is spinous process which is missing in case of midline laminectomy. And in a unilateral one, the lamina or laminotomy has been done. Ligamentum flavum has been excised. So you cannot rely on the anatomy as far as surgical decision is concerned. You might have to take this point into consideration. Also, along with that, you have scar tissue around your dissection. If the patient has undergone a midline laminectomy, if the patient has gone unilateral, you know that site or that area, it has to be dealt very carefully whenever you are doing the dissection on that side. So anatomic consideration is very, very important when you consider recurrent vis-a-vis a primary disc herniations. Considering the area of investigations, likewise primary disc herniation, you now want to know for sure the next pain is having, is it from the recurrent disc herniation? Is it epidural fibrosis which is presenting like a recurrent disc herniation on an MRI? Is it some scar tissue which is looking like a recurrent disc herniation? Is there a patient who is having some other cause of his pain and not because of the disc herniation? You have to be very, very careful in such situations. So you do area of investigation, repeat MRI. Sometimes if the creatinine is well, you do a contrast, gadolinium contrast enhanced MRI to know whether there's a rim enhancement, is there some infection underneath. So you do investigation probably at a more stringently, more effectively, so to you come down to a diagnosis. Along with that, there are other investigations which play a part. One of them is definitely an EMG-NCV. In certain conditions, you want to do EMG-NCV studies before subjecting patient for any further treatment. What are the surgical considerations when you talk about recurrent versus primary disc herniation? So a classical primary disc herniation, you think of doing a decompression discectomy. So whenever you think about recurrent, there are other options which opens up. Are you going to do a conservative treatment like a primary disc herniation, or do you want to go ahead and remove the whatever small fragment which has re-herniated and remove it off? Then whenever you think about surgery, are we going to fix it or are we doing just the discectomy? We don't want another surgery. The patient most of the time will give you an ultimatum that this is the last time I'm going to get operated. I want a thorough job. So you get biased toward whether you want to do a fixation, whether you want to just do the decompression discectomy and give another chance. So these are some important surgical consideration are there whenever you think about recurrent vis-a-vis a primary disc herniation. What about the complications? Are the complication rates same in recurrent? Are the complication rates higher in primary disc herniation? So we have a beautiful paper by Randall et al. And he has reported a 5 to 10% increased rate of complication whenever you are dealing with recurrent lumbar disc herniation surgery. So there is an added disadvantage. You know that whenever you are offering a treatment for a recurrent lumbar disc herniation, you have to add that X factor to it that the complications are now slightly higher. So whenever you take consent from the patient, you might have to explain this also and may not be a very pleasant thing to do. So along with that, what are the outcomes whenever you think about a recurrent lumbar disc herniation? So this was a beautiful paper in Spine Journal in 2017 itself by Robert et al. So here they have assessed the outcome, the risk factor, the analysis of the rate after in recurrent intervertebral disc herniation. And they had found out for sure, even after recurrent lumbar disc herniation, you offer treatment, be it a conservative treatment, be it in the form of epidural steroid, be it in the form of surgery, that is decompression discectomy versus fusion, definitely the ODI score, the Oswestry Disability Index score at pre-op versus the post-op is definitely improved. So whenever you go for a recurrent lumbar disc herniation treatment, you should rest assured that patient that you will get better. Yes, the complication rates are slightly notch higher compared to a primary disc herniation, but the outcomes are as good of probably as good as your primary disc herniation. But a very important part, especially in Indian setup, is the cost. Now imagine a patient, what I just showed you, he has already undergone surgery. Definitely, he may not be from the well-to-do family. He gets operated with the assurance that probably this will be his last surgery. He comes back after 3 months to your disarray that the patient is not doing well, patient is complaining again, not doing better. You have to explain him the cost. Now you have to explain him the cost for retreatment. You have to explain him the cost for surgery. Probably this surgery might be more than what we have done. You might have to offer fixation upon case-to-case basis. So if you take consideration the cost, and that too in an Indian setup, this is a study by Ambrosi et al., where they had seen what is the healthcare cost analysis, and they had found out it adds to approximately $26,000. Now this is a US-based study. So somewhere, if you have to extrapolate to Indian setup, it will be cost somewhere around 10 to 20 lakhs. Now this is a huge amount. If you consider the GDP index and all, probably it will be still less, but somewhere around 5 to 10 lakhs again. So this is an added cost which the patient had not signed for the first surgery. Probably you had explained it, but you along with the patient never expected it to happen. So yes, the cost is again a very, very important criteria when you compare a recurrent versus a primary disc herniation. So what went wrong? When we are discussing this, you saw the patient did well. Is there some patient-related factor that we have to consider whenever you think about a recurrent disc herniation? Are there some doctor-related or the surgery-related factor? Doctor won't be the right word, but a surgery-related factor which can be considered whenever you are thinking of a recurrent disc herniation. So both are important. So here, I want to know from our panelist, Dr. Jayesh Pawar. So when you think about recurrent disc herniation, now in your practice in Mumbai, I'm sure you would have seen your own case or cases referred or probably taken second opinion with you. And you have seen that the patient is not doing well. Patient is having a recurrent lumbar disc herniation. You yourself would have identified some factors which helps you to counsel the patient during the primary surgery also that, yes, I am going to operate you for your primary disc herniation. But now in your case especially, the chances of recurrent disc herniation is tad higher, supported by the literature as well as your personal experience. So Dr. Jayesh Pawar, what have you seen in your practice, which are the prominent risk factors when you talk about recurrent disc herniation?
The most prominent risk factors basically which matters are, see, it's not anywhere till now there is no level one evidence for this, but the most common risk factors are the smoking. So as smoking can cause vasoconstriction of the vessels to the healing disc, so it's a definitely a big risk factor. But along with that, obesity, patients with primary disc herniation going for operation who are having a BMI of more than 30, so it's mentioned by Merritt et al. Kids having a patient with BMI more than 30 have 12 times more higher risk of recurrent disc herniation and 12 times more higher risk of getting re-operated. So obesity is another cause for which definitely we should look for. Basically, BMI more than 30, along with the diabetes cells. Diabetes is another option where it impedes the healing of the disc. Example, if you are, why it causes the healing, impedition of healing, because it causes the glycolation cycle, which impedes the disc herniation and which causes the delay of the healing. So definitely this is another reason. But according to me, the most common reason is the biomechanical stress, any instability, means sagittal angle, angulation, if you are getting a flexion extension x-rays and where the angle is getting more than 10 degree, if there is instability in the previous surgery, there is past fracture, there is wide decompression, facet destruction, definitely these are the other reasons where there will be a higher chance of recurrent disc herniation. But still, if we are going to look in the literature, no one has given a level one evidence with significant results. Ki baba, these are the only reason. But these are mostly the common reason why we are seeing in the practice.
Right. So thank you, Dr. Jayesh, for a great input. Dr. Divakar, I would like to get your inputs on this. Are there any other risk factors which you have seen which Dr. Jayesh wouldn't have mentioned and which you want to prominently highlight?
Yeah. The level of disc degeneration to start with and the disc height. The disc height is really good. Then that means there is more disc to come out. And when it comes to the technique, endoscopy, transforaminal endoscopic surgeries, they have little higher recurrence rate. And yeah, along with the risk factors Jayesh quoted, maybe these things also might add up.
But there is one more thing. You, as rightly said by Dr. Divakar, this height do matter. But if it is severe disc height degeneration, if it is at the level of the stability, then these cases can, the recurrence rate are very low in such cases, if there is severe disc height degeneration.
Right. So we have already seen on these risk factors right from the young age. Very important factor is an age also. So if you have seen, yes, young patient, you tend to treat them conservatively for a very long time, because back of the mind you always know that if his disc has come out very early in his lifetime, probably he has another disc fragment to come out later on. So young age is one of them. Male gender, for obvious reason, one is the amount of stresses a male gender undergoes because of the hard labor they do. That is one of the reported risk factor in various literature. Obesity, yes. So we have other surgeries also. So this is an excellent paper again by Robert Abdu, spine journal, where they are assessing the risk factors associated with the recurrent disc herniation. And prominently, they found out that the male gender and young age at presentation was actually the risk factor in most of their case series. Whereas when they talked about smoking, it was not very great because they had smoking seen in cases of recurrent disc herniation and also in cases not undergoing a recurrent disc herniation. So there was a dilemma as far as smoking is concerned. Regarding obesity, yes, practically we do feel that obesity is one of the risk factors. And in my practice, I usually do explain to the patient that even if you are undergoing treatment surgery for your disc prolapse, probably you require some treatment for your obesity. Do get it under control either by some hormonal therapy if the patient is on some hormonal deficiency or some form of bariatric surgery to get it controlled. Otherwise, you'll land up in problem. But yes, the literature is still divided whether the obesity or a higher BMI does cause any disc prolapse. But yes, practically we do consider it as a risk factor. So whether a type of primary surgery, so as highlighted by Dr. Divakar, microendoscopics or the minimally invasive surgeries, because of the narrowed approach to the disc, there are chances of increased recurrent disc herniation and increased disc prolapse compared to an open surgery. But yes, we don't have a level one evidence or a randomized control trial proofing this. Annular defect, whether any annular or annulotomy which you do while removing the disc, or annular defect which is present after your discectomy, and the amount of disc removal, does it have any bearing on the recurrent disc herniation? So the answer is yes. So this paper by McCrut et al. Now this is an excellent paper in Spine in 2009, and this was taken from a registry from a national registry, and they found out the larger annular defects and less disc removal logically increases the risk of re-herniation. But again, no level one evidence is available, or no comparative studies is available to defy the same. So are there any radiological risk factors? Whenever you see the patient with a primary disc herniation, are there some clues in his or her x-rays or MRI which will prompt you to tell the patient or follow up the patient very closely when you think about a recurrent lumbar disc herniation? So two very important factors which have been mentioned repeatedly in literature is actually the disc height and the segmental motion. So as rightly said by both the panelists, that yes, the disc height, the amount of the disc which is present, the disc height will directly proportionately increase the chances of the herniation. Abnormal segmental motion at the index surgery will again lead to a chances of increased recurrent lumbar disc herniation. So which were again proved by Spine Journal by Kuan Tai Kim. So when you talk about recurrence, so you basically talk in two terms. Are you talking about an early recurrence or are you talking about a late recurrence? So early recurrence may be due to a re-herniation. It can be. Now here we are just talking about the symptomatology. A patient coming with a radiating pain down their leg. It can be because of the re-herniation. It can be because of the infection. It can be because of the arachnoiditis. The same DDs or the differential works whenever the patient comes for a later recurrence. Then you should always think about a foraminal stenosis secondary to a ligamentary hypertrophy, or because of the facet. Can be epidural fibrosis. There can be an iatrogenic segmental instability because of the thinning of the parts. And also it can be because of the progressive facetal degeneration. So these are the differentials you should think about whenever you think about a re-herniation or recurrence of the symptoms. Other than the re-herniation, you should always think about these differentials. To rule out this differential, what is important is always and always take a detailed history taking. You should not take any case, even if you have operated that patient for the first time, visits to you again. You should not take the symptomatology for granted. You should always take a detailed history. There might be something which will be missing. There might be something which has added over the period of time. And your always mind keeps on talking about re-herniation. So your detailed history is very important to rule out other factors and other conditions contributing to the pain. Along with that, you should always think about a vascular claudication. So this present symptom can be because of the vascular claudication, and your mind will completely mask because you have operated the patient and he presents with a similar kind of pain what he presented pre-op. And also you should always study whenever you have put an implant in the patient. So when do you talk about physical examination? So physical examination is very, very important, is absolutely gold standard whenever you are assessing a recurrent re-herniation patient. So you do a neurological examination, you check for the sagittal balance or sagittal parameters, you check for the peripheral pulse, you rule out whether the patient has any vascular kind of a claudication. Is the pain presently coming from a hip and SI joint? Never gets masked, never, because most of the time the patient is agitated, the patient is unhappy. He is already angry, he is already disappointed that the pain has come back, which you had told that 99% of the time, which is not going to be the case. Why me? Why I am suffering? Is it? And most of the time, it is the patients always trying to pinch out some mistakes from the surgeon. and try to overpower him. So that is the time your mind gets blocked and you don't look at these other areas like a peripheral pulse, a digital examination of the hip, a digital examination of the SI joint. So presently the patient's pain might be coming from the hip. The patient's present pain might be coming from the SI joint, which the patient is perceiving is because of the same problem. So you always think about this. Along with that, never and never in your life avoid taking blood. So always check for Waddell's sign. So these Waddell's sign are basically to rule out the non-organic, the functional causes of the symptoms. The patient might be having an exaggerated pain response. It might be having a superficial examination manual pain. He might be simulating spinal testing. He might be on regionalization. You see that the patient is not classically having a dermatomal or a myotomal type of distribution. When you do an SLR for the patient at 30 degree, patient was complaining pain. But then when you did at sitting SLR, the patient was not having pain. You should think about this. Waddell's sign is very important when you're talking about recurrent disc herniation. Psychological assessment is another important part. And I'm sure everyone should be doing all these Waddell's sign as well as psychological assessment when they are treating primary disc herniation. So more so in recurrent disc herniation, it becomes an added thing to re-examine the patient, re-examine the neurology, peripheral pulse, hip and SI joint whenever the patient reports back. So when you have done the history, you have assessed the patient examination, now comes the very important part, investigations. So there is always a dilemma. Is the recurrent, we discussed a while ago, the recurrent disc herniation versus vis-a-vis a primary disc herniation, the area of investigations are slightly different. They are slightly more compared to whenever you are talking about a recurrent disc herniation. So here I want to have an opinion from the panelists. So Dr. Divakar, how do you differently investigate the patient whenever a patient, especially operated by you, mind you, the patient has already undergone knife under you and the patient was doing well, patient has reported back with the similar symptoms, which the patient is claiming that they are similar, as they were probably more. Most of the time they say that the pain has probably increased now and it was not there even before the first period. So how do you investigate patient? Do you do it differently or do you do the way you are doing? So Dr. Divakar.
When patient comes back, who has undergone surgery somewhere else or under us.
Yeah. So
history taking, like you said, and the physical examination. And in history, we have to ask about how the pain is, the dermatomal pattern. Is it similar like the previous one? Because for patient, it is again the leg pain or the back pain. But for us, if we can localize, then maybe we can get some idea about where the disc herniation is. And our examination, again, neurological examination might guide us the level of herniation, whether it is the same or maybe the different level. And then when we come to radiological examination, MRI will be confirmatory most of but the plain MRI, which we do regularly for all the primary patients, may have some confusing picture. Because the epidural fibrosis looks like a disc. It is all black. Either fibrosis, it is a disc, it is all black. So, gadolinium will help. Gadolinium enhanced contrast MRI will help to differentiate the disc. But most of the times, the patient may not be getting the gadolinium enhanced MRI. Most of the times, we get the plain MRI. But I personally feel that gadolinium enhanced MRI should be done if we are suspecting a recurrent disc at the recurrent disc. And along with that, if patient is diabetic or a radicular pattern, EMG NCV will help definitely.
Along with that, I would like to add about the hamstring tightness. Most of the time, patient with recurrent disc herniation who has having a primary surgery, we are given a long duration of conservative trial, might develop a hamstring tightness, which they can complain of the same thing later on. So even that we have to look for, hamstring tightness.
Yes.
So, Dr. Jayesh, any role for diagnostic selective nerve root blocks? Do you do oftenly in your practice, or do you reserve for some cases which you want to really?
The thing is, before going for a surgery for a second time, we should be, see, it's a gold standard for diagnosis for the disc herniation. If it is recurrent and if you are not sure whether it's related to the disc herniation from the same level, or if there is some adjacent level degeneration at the above level, whether is that is the disc level involving into the pain symptoms right now. So definitely, but that will be followed, that root block will be followed by a conservative, it will preclude a bit of conservative management first. Definitely, right. Conservative management is not responding, the patient is not responding to it, and definitely we should think of root management, root block.
Right.
But definitely prior to that, conservative management and followed by a root block. That will help, definitely could guide you, Baba, this is the only region from the where the pain is originating. Otherwise, this might mislead you.
So, I think beautifully explained by both the panelists. So yes, the area of investigations are slightly different or rather added up in cases of recurrent lumbar disc herniation, and which can be very well done for your primaries also. But you don't usually thoroughly investigate the patient whenever you have a clinical or radiological match. So yes, whenever you have a clinical radiological match, you might have to you have to tell the patient to undergo EMG and CV. You might require a diagnostic selective nerve root block whenever there's an adjacent level which was not there earlier and now it is seen. So you want to know where the patient's pain is arising from. So very nicely mentioned. So this has been really mentioned in most of the literature. So compared to a normal or a routine MRI scan, a gadolinium enhanced MRI are preferred whenever you are reassessing the patient in the post-op period or in late post-op period. Whenever you talk about this, you talk about a Lebo paper. So this Lebo paper, which was published in Spine Journal at 2011, and this was what they did was they had done asymptomatic same site recurrent disc herniation longitudinal study for 2 year serial imaging, and what their reporting was, so 1/4 of the patient which had undergone lumbar disc herniation surgery in the form of discectomy had recurrent disc herniation on MRI, but symptomatic, only few of them were there. So majorly were asymptomatic, only very few were symptomatic for the recurrent disc herniation. And on serial follow-up for 2 years, they found that who were asymptomatic at the start remained asymptomatic for the next 2 years also. So this was a very important paper by Lebo et al. And again, it was co-authored by Maggart et al. So another important thing is the efficacy of selective nerve root block. So whenever there is a diagnostic dilemma, never hesitate to do a selective nerve root block to know whether this patient is having this pain from because of your present recurrent disc herniation and not because of some XYZ problem. So all it helps you to narrow it down your differentials and it helps you to come to a pinpoint diagnosis. Blood investigations, whenever you have a slightest of doubt as far as the epidural soft tissue is concerned, whether it is a soft tissue secondary to infection or is it a post-operative changes because of some granulation tissue. So you want to do a complete blood count. You want to see whether the patient total leukocyte has it increased, is it the same, is it the ESR which is raised, CRP which is raised. So you saw in the previous patients in the differentials, one of the differential was surgical site infection. So we have seen cases, surgical site infection can occur anyway between 0 to 1 year of your index surgery. So you should always have a higher suspicion whenever the patient presents with a similar symptom. So now back to the same patient, the patient is presented 12 weeks post-op, recurrence of symptoms, had low back pain, right lower limb pain. Patient had also hydronephrosis, so he had undergone a stent surgery. So whenever the patient undergoes a urinary tract surgery following your primary surgery, as a surgeon, you are synced. You always feel now the infection would have set in because of the bacteremia from the previous procedure, and probably I am dealing with infection. So when we did an MRI of the same patient, you can see the sagittal cuts here. So there was a re-herniation at the same level. And again, it was on the right side and the patient was symptomatic for the right side. So now what? Are we going to offer the patient resurgery immediately? Are we going through the same options of conservative followed by SOS surgery? So as far as the literature is concerned, even in my practice, what I do is, now this recurrent lumbar disc herniation essentially behaves a similar way as your primary disc herniation and does mandate a conservative trial before you opt for any intervention, any surgical intervention. So conservative trial in the form of rest, medications, physiotherapy, what would have done for a primary disc herniation should have been tried again, as well as an epidural steroid or a selective ulnar root block, which can act as a diagnostic as well as therapeutic option, should be tried first, exhausted first before opting for any form of surgical intervention. So which is very important, not all the recurrent disc herniation, even if the patient has been operated by your colleague or somewhere outside and comes to you within 1 week complaints of pain, should you offer a surgery to them. You can always try a conservative trial. Yes, the patient is not getting better with a conservative trial. The patient's symptom matches clinical radiologically to the level of surgery. Yes, you can offer the patient surgery and only after a failed conservative trial. There, in some cases, whenever the patient's symptoms are very painful, the patient is very painful, the VAS score is 10 by 10 after giving repeated different analgesics, the patient's pain is not getting settled. Yes, and you can intervene early in the those scenarios whenever you feel that the patient is uncomfortable and may not sustain the conservative trial as far as pain is concerned. You can always give an option of surgical intervention. Now, whenever you talk about surgical intervention, surgical options, so what you take into considerations, it is true with any primary surgeries also, but more so in a recurrent lumbar disc herniation, whenever the patient is undergoing second time knife, whenever there is cost which is at a factor, your surgery which the patient is might blame because that you have already operated the patient and the patient has to undergo the same surgery again, you think of these two very important things. One, you think about the cost effectiveness of your procedure, and along with that you also think about the morbidity. Is my surgery going to be more morbid to the patient? Is there any less morbid procedure which I can do and give the benefit to the patient? So the less is more whenever you talk about the recurrent disc herniation. So there, this is a very good paper by Ambrose et al. In US, and this was a survey-based paper where he wanted to study the variability of offering the treatment option whenever the patient of recurrent lumbar disc herniation presented to spine surgeons in US. So a drastic or a distinct change he had seen was surgeons in practice who were in practice for more than 15 to 20 years sorted for a revision microdiscectomy over fusion surgeries, but highly performing surgeries or the high volumes operating surgeons who are doing surgeries more than 200 per year opted for fusion surgery compared to microdiscectomy. So this was what his study was, and there was a wide variation what the surgeon offered to the patient and what the patient underwent because of the recurrent lumbar disc herniation. So this, now the book is open. Now we have options like discectomy, or you can do fusion surgery. So when you talk about fusion surgery, what fusion surgery? Are you talking about PLFER, which is a posterolateral fusion? Are you talking about a PLIF, that is a posterior lumbar interbody fusion? Are you talking about a TLIF, which is a transforaminal lumbar interbody fusion? So there are a few of these papers who are comparing methods without fusion. So whenever you talk about without fusion, decompression, discectomy, are you now planning for endoscopic surgery? Are you planning to do an open lumbar microdiscectomy? Are you going to do a tubular discectomy? So this is a paper by Lee et al. Which compared the percutaneous endoscopic versus the open, and he found out there was not much change as far as long-term outcome was concerned. Yes, in the short term, the patient had little pain whenever the patient underwent a percutaneous endoscopic, and also the patient's stay was less in case of endoscopic group, but in a longer setup or a longer follow-up, they fared the same. There was not much difference. This is a very important paper to decide. This is in 2019 by Carrion et al. And again co-authored by Stephen Glassman, who is one of the authority in spine surgery. In his setup, he had discussed two parts. Whenever a spine surgeon is asked whether you want to do a fusion or what are your indications for fusion surgery, the two prominent things comes in your mind is amount of facetectomy done in the primary surgery, along with that, what is the present instability level. Is the patient unstable? Is there a listasis at that level? Immediately, once you see a facet being resected more, as high as 16 to 20% of the facet, and whenever you think about there is an instability, you are biased towards doing a fusion surgery. But this study, which involved 94 cases, found out there was not much difference whenever you opted for fusion surgery vis-a-vis a discectomy surgery. So according to this first episode, recurrent disc herniation, surgeon can expect similar outcomes whenever they opt for decompression alone or decompression and fusion alone. And here the patient ODI score was C, that is the Oswestry Disability Index. So whenever you think about fusion surgery, so when you fare out, what about discectomy versus fusion? Is it the same, or is it discectomy has an upper hand compared to a fusion surgery? So the paper by Few et al. Now in this paper, they had compared the PLD or the PLIF versus the discectomy group. In this, they had found out that the amount of discectomy or the amount of surgery they did in terms of discectomy versus the fusion surgery, the outcomes were similar. There was not much difference whenever they considered the complication rate as well as the outcome. So they had a similar outcome. So similar paper by Fu et al., who had compared discectomy with PLS, that is the posterior lateral fusion, they found out that there was not much difference as far as the outcome and complication rates were concerned. This was a paper by Ayman et al. Here they compared the three surgical techniques, that is PLIF, PLIF, as well as discectomy, and they found no difference whenever they followed up the patient for more than 2 years and with a mean follow-up of 37 months. So comparing, when you talk about methods of fusion, so now we have understood that the discectomy versus fusion, it doesn't vary much. Probably case to case, it will vary. Whether you opt for discectomy or fusion, there are no clear indication when you talk about fusion surgery. When you talk about what fusion surgery, still the literature is divided. There is no one surgery having an upper hand over the other as far as outcome is concerned. Yes, minimal versus open TLIF, the duration of surgery, the amount of blood loss, the chances of dural tear are slightly lesser in minimal invasive, but overall the outcome remained the same. Not much difference whenever they discuss these two options. Percutaneous pedicle screw, MIS TLIF versus open TLIF in a revision surgery by Nish et al. didn't provide much input into which one is better over the other. Had excellent outcomes in both the TLIF groups, in an open TLIF as well as MIS TLIF. Sonmez et al., where they did a unilateral percutaneous pedicle screw fixation. So this was very important whenever you talk about a unilateral pedicle screw, since already the anatomy is disturbed. You don't have to go on either side of the around the facet and dissect it out and do it. You can just go unilaterally, do the facetectomy, do the discectomy on that side whenever the patient is having unilateral symptoms, jack up the disc head, put a pedicle screw, and the patient would do fine. And the outcomes, recently a multicentric trial, actually it's a meta-analysis of all the randomized control trial, and suggested that the percutaneous, the unilateral fixation versus bilateral fixation, no one technique was above over the other. So you can very well do a unilateral percutaneous screw. So when you talk about a systematic review like this, now this is a 2020 paper, after so many years of studies and different studies and case series available, still we are not very sure. Still we are not very sure whether the fusion surgery has an upper hand. Literature is still divided when you talk about them. Some studies showing a discectomy favoring studies, some studies favoring fusion studies. But as far as the healthcare options and healthcare outcome is concerned, both are doing similar. They are not, there is no clear cut indication, or you can say clear cut upper hand of fusion or discectomy surgery. So when you talk about fusion surgery, so there is no doubt fusion surgery is relatively simpler. You have a safe approach. You remove the facet. You don't have to go through the same scar tissue again. You just have to take a lateral approach where there is not much dissection around the dural sac and nerve root. Do a discectomy from a far lateral approach. Remove the disc, remove the impending disc, free the nerve root from one side. The chances of dural tear, neurological deficit overall is low with TLIF. That is a transforaminal lumbar approach, lumbar interbody fusion surgery, and more so with the revision spine surgery. When you are going through a relatively virgin area, you don't have to dig in the center. My indication, or rather, which has been repeatedly being mentioned in literature, there are three main indications. One is instability, second is degenerative changes, and third is chronic low back pain. But these are not an absolute indication, and you have to take your decision of doing a fusion surgery vis-a-vis a discectomy surgery on case-to-case basis. But yes, instability, degenerative changes, patient having chronic low back pain, you tend to offer him a fusion surgery or a discectomy surgery, but no clear level one study is still available to defy the same. So just to give a heads up, what exactly we do in a TLIF. So if you see, you can do a bilateral exposure or you can do a unilateral exposure. You can see in between, that soft tissue mass is kept like that. You directly approach the facets on either side and do a fixation. You can put screws on one side, then you do a fluoroscopic guided fixation on the other side. You can see a unilateral TLIF approach. You can remove the inferior articular process. After removing the inferior articular process, remove the superior articular process, and this is the TLIF window. What we call is a safe door entry. That is a transforaminal lumbar interbody fusion. Here you can see the dural sac and the nerve root need not be retracted. It is very well placed in between, and you can do a discectomy, remove the impending disc or the problem creating disc, do a full thorough job of discectomy fusion. Here you can do a ipsilateral facetectomy, remove it by the osteotome. You might have to protect your exiting and traversing nerve root. You need not retract them much. Do an annulotomy, do a discectomy. Once you do a discectomy with repeated disc for forward and a forward pituitary rupture, remove the disc as far as possible. Prepare the intervertebral space by doing curettage, by using grass. You prepare nicely, make a nice fusion bed. Whatever facet has been removed can be used for the bone graft. Since you have already done the laminectomy in most of the midline surgery, you don't have much bone graft. You might have to add bone substitutes to it. You might have to add bone marrow to it. You might have to add iliac crest to it. Make a nice bone graft which has an osteoinductive as well as osteoconductive effect. Put the cage in between. Pack it nice with the bone graft. Put the cage, jack up the height. And here you can see it has been inserted from unilateral approach, and then you can confirm under fluoroscopy the final position, and this is what you will achieve. So with this, you have understood the indications, what are the risk factors whenever you talk about recurrent lumbar disc herniation, how do you identify them? Whenever a patient presents to you with a likely recurrent lumbar disc herniation, what are the other differentials you should keep in your mind? How to come narrow down your diagnosis to recurrent lumbar disc herniation. Never ever in your life directly give a second option. Patient can do well with another conservative trial for recurrent lumbar disc herniation. Once you fail the conservative trial, the patient has failed the conservative trial, now you want to opt for any surgical intervention, you have to weigh the cost benefits. You also have to weigh the other benefits like the amount of surgery, the age of the patient, also you have to consider the amount of facet which was removed during the primary surgery. Is there any safe window available to just do the discectomy, or you might have to remove the facet? Is the herniation more foraminal than paracentral? In that case, you might have to remove the facet, remove the disc from the foramen and do a fusion surgery. So it will vary from case to case basis, and the final decision whether to go and discectomy or fusion surgery has to be consented, discussed well with the patient, and then offered. So with this, I've just summarized what we have intended to learn today. Along with this, now I want the panelists' word in. I'll be discussing a few cases. So Dr. Jayesh, Dr. Divakar, here we have one case, a 32-year-old male who is an engineer who presented with a severe back pain radiating down to the left lower limb, tingling and numbness, difficulty while walking. On examination, the patient had left EHL EDL weak, and he gives a history of previous endoscopic discectomy done 7 months back elsewhere. Patient presents to you with the same symptoms. He is not a happy patient. He's already frustrated. He has prepared his mind that probably he has to undergo the knife again because he had a similar symptoms earlier. So how do you approach this patient? Dr. Jayesh, will start with you. This is the MRI of the patient.
It was operated at L5-S1 previously, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So he is engineer, means he is saying, okay, so it was operated at L5-S1. So definitely, the disc height is well maintained. There are X-rays available, any flexion extension?
We don't have the flexion extension, but take my word that there was not any instability at that level.
Okay. So endoscopic procedure, there is less likely chance of instability, any iatrogenic fracture, because endoscopy only, it aims to the Campion strangle. So the thought of instability post-surgical is ruled out in this. So definitely, he is a young guy, old, hard worker. So definitely, we should give a conservative trial before doing any type of investigation. If he comes to me now, definitely I will give us 1 week of conservative trial with anti-inflammatory, with neuromodulator medications. And I will look for him for a period of 1 week, around 3 weeks.
Right. The patient has already visited his primary surgeon. He has already undergone 3 months of conservative trial. He was not very keen. The primary surgeon was not very keen in taking an MRI, but since the patient was not doing well for 3 months, he has forced the doctor to kindly go for an MRI. I want to know, why am I having the pain? Is there something wrong? With the brief discussion with the patient, the surgeon has agreed and he has taken this MRI. So with this background history, patient would have tried a pain block also. He has tried a pain block. He had done all the conservative trial before. Now, what is the situation? Do you still want to offer him the same medications? Because the patient is frustrated now.
Okay. Can you turn over to MRI, please?
Yeah.
Yes. So as per the MRI, the disc height is well maintained. The facets are well aligned. So if conservative and root block have failed, then definitely the only option left with me is to undergo for the surgery. So in this case, I would like to go for a revision microdiscectomy. So definitely from my side, I'm good in delivering microdiscectomy surgeries. So definitely I will go for this day.
So you will plan for an open microdiscectomy, a unilateral approach, right?
Unilateral approach. But at least my physical examination, it should be evident that it's the pain is related to this type of disc only, and nowhere other related type of disc. Like there is no hamstring tightness, there is no other neuropathy, or there is. Right. So this should be indicated by physical examination, Baba. This the type of pain which he is having is radiating from this disc only and from nowhere else, because the rest of the disc seems normal in the MRI right now. So definitely after a trial of conservative management, root block, and if the patient is still having that point of pain, then definitely we should have to go for another option, that is surgery. So from my side, I will go for microendoscopy.
Right. So MED is what is your option? Is a microdiscectomy, microendoscopy discectomy. So first of all, Dr. Divakar, any inputs on this case? Do you want to do fusion surgery for this?
So now
you mentioned tall disc height, young patient. Already coming back to you, screaming in pain, probably screaming more because if he has to undergo surgery again.
You mentioned neurological defect, if I am not wrong. Then I feel we have to operate. He has to be offered a surgery. And microendoscopic discectomy in patients who have undergone transforaminal lumbar endoscopic discectomy, I think the second procedure will be easier because the incision is somewhere else and the amount of fibrosis which you come across in the canal is less, right, unlike the repeat revision microscopic discectomy. Considering the patient's clinical symptoms and the neurological deficits he is having and the amount of conservative management he already undergone, I think he has to be offered a surgery.
Right. So I agree that first of all, endoscopy at an alpha S1 junction is really challenging. Many a times you have to make an iliac window to do a endoscopic surgery at that level. But yes, I completely agree here that doing a re-endoscopic surgery is kind of challenging because you have to go through the same cambium triangle, same foramen again. So a transforaminal surgery is not what I would offer. I would offer something like a micro or a tubular discectomy, whichever patients opt for, with both explaining both pros and cons. But Dr. Jayesh, Dr. Diwakar, do you feel that you have to do an open just because it's a revision surgery, or you can still go ahead and do a tubular?
You can do tubular. What I mean, meant by posterior surgery.
Right.
Because posterior surgeries are virgin tissues. They are not injured. They are not fibrotic. There won't be any scar tissue. So the surgery also will be easier.
Into a virgin area, basically.
Yeah.
Right, right. So I agree, depending upon the surgeon's choice, whether he wants to go ahead and do MED.
It's a surgeon preference. It's a surgeon preference. And definitely the alpha S1 re-disc herniation are less forgiving. They are forgiving because it's a roomy area, alpha S1.
Right.
So they are a bit of forgiving, but still the patient complains of neurodeficit, and we should proceed with the surgery there. We should give him an option. We should counseling. Counseling is the most important thing in these types of patients.
Right. So a thorough counseling, as rightly said by Dr. Pawar, that thorough counseling is very important, explaining them that chances of re-herniation is also there. You cannot just completely negate that factor that even if I do a tubular or if I do a MED, the chances of re-herniation again is zero. No, it is not. You can still have a re-herniation. Most of the time it is asymptomatic, as suggested by a paper by Liebo et al. But yes, the chances of re-herniation are there. So if the patient is ready to accept that as a complication of your surgery, you can offer in the surgery, option of surgery, and then probably wait and watch. So we, as rightly said by both the panelists, we opted also for a microdiscectomy. Patient underwent a microdiscectomy surgery, is doing well now, no complaints henceforth. So not that because he was operated elsewhere, but yes, our own surgeries can have such a results of re-herniation. It can be there in open microdiscectomy. It can be there in tubular discectomies. There is literature divided whether the MIS increases the chances of re-herniation, but there will be some chances of re-herniation, as reported by literature, is as high as 5 to 25%. So with this, we'll go for the second case. Now we have a 31-year-old male, a similar age group guy, who presented with L4-S1 decompression 2.5 years ago, complains of severe right lower limb radiation. On examination, the right SLR is restricted. There is neurologically, the patient has 5x5 power. Here's this was operated by us and had a relatively good outcome for 2.5 years. This was his dynamic X-rays. So this was his MRI suggesting, you can see almost a midline herniation at 4-5 level and a right alpha S1 paracentral extrusion. So with this history and MRI findings, any thoughts on the options of treatment? Dr. Diwakar?
Can you show the MRI, please? L4 to S1 decompression was done prior.
L4 to S1 was done, yeah.
Again, there is an annular tear at L4-5 and it looks like disc at L5-S1 on right side.
Okay.
So it was more of an axial pain or radiating pain?
Radiating pain. He had both back and leg pain and it was equal.
Okay.
The amount was equal. The severity of VAST was same, 8 by 10. Already taken conservative trial in forms of physiotherapy, medication, rest. Along with that, some epidural steroid had intermittent relief.
The axial pain might be due to L4-5 annular tear, but as per all the conservative trial has been exhausted, and I will definitely on the MRI we can see there is disc height degeneration, there is disc height reduction at L5-S1 significantly. So.
I would like to see the foraminal cuts because L5-S1 disc space is almost like completely collapsed.
Right. So foraminal cut
of L5-S1.
So, since I don't have the cuts here, you have to trust my wordings here that the foraminal cuts were showing grade 2 Lee stenosis. So as far as the Lee's grading are concerned, the epidural fat was decrease around the neural, the perineural fat was obliterated in uniplane, that is from supero inferior direction, but antero posterior the perineural fat was intact.
In this case, I would like to go for a fusion in this case, at least for L5-S1 level, and along with the fusion, I would like to means in fusion will be in the form of transforaminal lumbar interbody fusion. So there will be no issue of any tissue scarring, fibrosis. There will be minimal retraction of the cord in the TLIF procedure.
You will go L4-S1 TLIF or you will just do L5-S1?
L5-S1. 4-5 seems
just 5-S1.
Yes.
Okay. But 4-5 is already degenerated. Probably on a 4 months grade, it is grade 3 on 5. And also, there is already annular tear.
Still, I would go for L5-S1, definitely. Because annular tear is not an indication for the fusion to extend.
Okay.
But on a setting...
So, are you sure that the pain is from the 5-S1 alone and not the 4-5?
Because as per your history... The radiating pain is more as compared to the axial pain.
Right.
Definitely.
Both same. Back as well as leg pain is same, 8 by 10.
Still L5-S1, definitely.
Okay. Dr. Divakar, any inputs? You would, we already have one pro for fusion surgery here and he wants to do a minimal fusion, that is 5-S1. And you want to do a TLIF. You want to do a bilateral or a unilateral approach?
Unilateral.
Doctor,
patient is having unilateral symptoms.
But you want to do bilateral fixation or a unilateral fixation?
No. Bilateral fixation and fenestration approach only on the right side.
Okay. Oh, Dr. Divakar, any inputs?
Yeah, I would explain. I would go with the plan, what Jayesh has mentioned. But I would be very cautious about the L4-5 level.
Okay. What about only discectomy decompression? The facet seems to be very well preserved. If you see the percentage of facetal loss, it's not more than 10%. It's almost same on the other side. Just do a 5-S1. Don't have to worry about the 4-5 undergoing adjacent segment degeneration. Any thoughts on that?
But L5-S1 space is already collapsed. If we go only for discectomy, I think we'll further decrease the disc height. And patient is just 31. More disc is already degenerated.
Right.
The basis, see, previously also we have done a posterior surgery. Okay. So in a posterior surgery, again going to that area where there is a scarring, fibrosis, there will be tissue fibrosis along with the nerve fibrosis along the side. So there are chances of nerve root retraction, the injury while during a nerve root retraction. Even while we are doing a discectomy, we have to do an aggravated and aggressive discectomy in this level. Okay. So it's better to go for a fusion in this case, as per my opinion.
Right. So I agree that here the spinopelvic parameters are deranged. But here the two things to be considered is actually the age of the patient. Patient is just 31 and you are fusing the patient at that level. There is another level which is ready to topple, that is at 4-5. Whether to do fusion surgeries or just do a decompression surgeries and await further adjacent segment degeneration. But I completely agree with the fact that the disc is already degenerated, it's half the disc height. It is going to progress, probably he'll end up with a foraminal stenosis and you might have to do a fusion surgeries then. So the literature here itself, you can see that the panelists are not on one page as far as surgery is concerned. Some is favoring TLIF, then some is favoring only 4-5, 5S1. Some is you might have to involve 4, just do a PLF at 4-5. That's another option. So to really come down and narrow down to the problem, you know, you definitely require some guideline. So these are the recommendations by Donald Rajan et al. This is a systematic review published in 2016. So these were the different recommendations for such cases, where it was not very hunky-dory that this is 1+1=2. It's not like that. You have to take different parameters into consideration. The age, the disc height, the disc herniation. Is it the single level? Is it the multiple level? What was the previous surgery level? What is the adjacent disc status as far as the Furman's grading are concerned? So you require something, a comparative study, a randomized controlled trial. I agree it is not very easy. In such a setup, it's not very easy. If for the last 15-20 years, we are still revolving around the same question, a recurrent disc herniation fusion versus discectomy, you still don't have a very clear answer. A paper recently published in 2020, Neuroscience Journal, says the same thing. So with this, I'll keep everyone in limbo that there is no clear-cut guideline that you should do only discectomy, you should do only fusion surgery. Yes, there are advantages of decompression discectomy as far as the amount of blood loss, the amount of hospital stay, the amount of cost which is involved, vis-a-vis a fusion surgery, which is slightly costlier, more hospital stay, longer duration of surgery, more blood loss. But then you should also look at the other factors like the age of the patient, what level we are talking about, what is the facet status, whether the patient is unstable, whether the patient is having back or the leg pain, or is it both are the same, or leg or the back pain. So you take multiple points into consideration and each case has to be dealt as a solo case. You should not apply all the laws of physics there. You have to treat each patient as a new case and consider all these factors before taking a decision making. So with this, I wanted to thank Dr. Jayesh Pawar, Dr. Divakar for being an esteemed panelist in the discussion, nicely with the nice inputs in the subject. Also, Dr. Ashok Shyam for giving this platform for us to present such a scenarios, and also to our management head, Rahul Chaubey, for giving an opportunity to present here, and also the Sancheti team and Dr. Parag Sancheti for giving us the opportunity. With this, I'll conclude the lecture. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Raman.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Ashok Shyam, sir.